Ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to join my good friend and distinguished colleague, Ed Markey, who is chairman of the Select Committee on Energy Independence and Global Warming, in welcoming the Prime Minister of Sweden, Fredrik Reinfeldt, to our joint committee briefing. With all due respect to Swedish tradition, if there were a Nobel Prize in championing the environment, I would nominate Ed Markey for it. So, Mr. Chairman, it's all yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much. And we thank you for hosting this meeting today, co-hosting it, along with the Speaker's Select Committee on Energy Independence and Global Warming. We welcome the Prime Minister to the House of Representatives with this joint briefing with your committee, the Committee on Foreign Affairs. The Prime Minister assumed office last October after leading the moderate party since 2003 and becoming a member of the Swedish Parliament since 1991. We are grateful that the Prime Minister is taking the time to brief our committees on his views on the global challenges and opportunities related to climate change and energy policy. As an Arctic nation on the front lines of global warming, Sweden is a shining example of what can be accomplished when a nation commits to cutting oil dependence and fighting global warming. In 1970, oil accounted for 70% of their total energy supply. Today, they have reduced that to 30%. In addition, Sweden has proven that cutting global warming pollution can go hand in hand with economic expansion. Between 1990 and 2005, Sweden reduced its heat-trapping emissions by 7% while growing the economy by 36%. You don't have to have a Nobel Prize in economics to appreciate those numbers. And they are not stopping there. Sweden now plans to completely eliminate their dependence on oil in the next few decades and achieve even deeper cuts in global warming pollution by mid-century. Environmental technologies already make up 10% of their economy, and they are focused on growing this sector by developing new energy efficiency and renewable energy technologies. We've always known that Sweden is an international leader in clean design. Now they are also an international leader on clean energy. Mr. Chairman, we thank you so much for co-chairing this hearing with us. It is an issue that now has commanded the attention of the world. Sweden is a leader, I yield back the balance of my time.
Well, before I turn to our distinguished guest, I'd like to turn to my good friend and distinguished colleague on the Republican side, Chairman Sensenbrenner.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I, too, would like to thank the Prime Minister for taking the time to share with us Sweden's experience with climate change and energy independence. Long before today's international focus on the global warming issue, Sweden made the policy decision not to rely heavily on foreign-supplied fossil fuels for its energy future. Instead, Sweden turned to nuclear and hydropower for most of its electricity needs. As a result, Sweden has seen reductions in its greenhouse gas emissions. Furthermore, by relying on nuclear and hydroelectricity, Sweden is far less dependent on foreign sources of oil than America. Mr. Prime Minister, in the United States, we call that a win-win. With gas prices rising higher and higher here, we Americans are anxious to become more energy independent ourselves. Global warming is a global issue, and as we look for solutions, I think it's important to see what works in other countries. It looks like nuclear and hydropower are working in Sweden, and I'm anxious to hear from the Prime Minister about how these and other technologies can reduce carbon emissions and reliance on foreign energy sources. Many of my colleagues believe, as do I, that climate change policy has to promote the development of new technology if it is to have a significant impact. Mr. Prime Minister, I'm concerned that the United States may overreact to what science is telling us about global warming and enact policies that do little to improve the environment while causing significant harm to our economy. I also worry that if China and India are not part of the solution, these rapidly growing nations will emit enough greenhouse gases to effectively undo any progress made by countries that are reducing their greenhouse gas emissions. I hope you will share with us some thoughts about how Sweden, the European Union, and the United States can persuade the Indians and Chinese to become more involved in these solutions. It would be hard for me and many of my colleagues to support any significant global warming policy that doesn't include China and India. With that, I'd like to thank the Prime Minister again for being here and look forward to hearing his thoughts on these important issues.
Thank you very much. The Damocles sword of the bells is hanging over us, but if any of my colleagues would like to make an opening statement, I'll be happy to recognize them. If not, then I'm delighted to turn the microphone over to our most distinguished guest, the Prime Minister of Sweden.
Thank you very much for that, Mr. Chairman, distinguished members of the committee. Thank you for kind words. Thank you for great knowledge in European and Swedish affairs. It's an honor for me to appear here today. And I know that there is a tendency in politics that when you get new information, you tend to say, well, now the end is near. I've heard that before. And perhaps others might find that a constructive contribution to the debate. But those kind of doomsday prophecies do not appeal to me. I am, however, convinced about a few things. I'm convinced that we should listen to people's worries about what is happening to our world. I'm convinced that we should listen to the analyses and conclusions written by leading scientists. I am convinced that when people worry about climate change and leading scientists tell us that this thing is for real, then we must not just listen, we must take action. Today we can say a few things for sure. Our climate is going through a change. It is a global change that affects all of us. It means that step by step our world is getting warmer and it's happening fast. And it's a change for the worse. Mankind is one major reason for this development. The exact consequences we don't fully know, but we can be sure it will affect the conditions for life on our planet for the worse. In some parts of our world, global warming will result in water shortages, drought, and growing deserts. In other parts, it will lead to increased rain, storms, and flooding. This is what science tells us. Science also tells us the good news. It tells us that we can do something to slow down and stop this development. We have most of the knowledge and technology we need. Also, the costs can be handled if we go about it the right way. Those of you who have been around for a while remember the old style of policy making on environmental issues. I certainly do. Regulation, intervention in people's lives, singling out economic growth as the main problem. That's not how to do it anymore. There's been a big shift in thinking. Today, science is pointing to private ownership, free enterprise, market mechanisms, research and technology as important tools to tackle global warming. All governments in the IPCC agreed that we can have economic growth and tackle climate change at the same time. There's just one thing we must accept. If we really want to make a difference and tackle global warming, we must act together. Global questions of this kind cannot be handled by single nations, especially not a small country like my own. They demand global solutions and global action. This need for global action becomes obvious if we take a look at the world around us. Today, emerging economies are trying to bring their people out of poverty and are taking leaps towards development and prosperity. More and more people in our world get to live the life of modern technology and consumption. This is something we should embrace. But with development and prosperity comes increased emissions. To obtain a sufficient energy supply, these countries see now no other option than to burn coal, oil, and gas. Just take China and India. China became a net oil importer in 1993. Only 13 years later, in 2006, China was the world's largest oil consumer after the United States. China was the third largest oil importer after the US and Japan. According to research by the Asia Pacific Energy Research Center, China's oil import dependency will rise from the current level of 40% to approximately 70% by 2020. But we have to remember one thing. China's growth is partially due to Western demand for China to produce goods cheaply. Therefore, the emissions actually occur in China instead of in other countries. China is trying to tackle its energy and climate challenge. I think it's only fair to say that China is at a crucial phase where it wants to decouple economic growth from CO2 emissions. We all need to recognize that it is in our national interests for China to develop in a lower carbon fashion. We should be developing smart solutions and approaches to make that happen. Such an approach is key, as China will soon surpass the US as the world's largest emitter. And India is following along the same path, although somewhat more slowly. India already imports 70% of its oil needs. Last year, it consumed a little over 2 million barrels a day. A government paper has forecast that by 2025, India's consumption will have more than tripled to 7.4 million barrels a day. This means that we are at a critical point in the energy and climate security debate. Is this only the beginning of a trend of increasing greenhouse gas emissions? Or do we manage now, through smart approaches and determination, to turn the curve and begin truly decarbonizing our economic growth? We know that if current emissions trends continue, we will alter global climate. It will be to an extent that we will significantly change the living conditions of people all over the world. This will have serious implications for a vast number of people and ecosystems. It's also possible that rising sea levels will reshape the continents within just a few centuries. I read with interest the five-star generals and admirals representing all the military services on the security implications of climate change for the US. Doing national intelligence estimates on climate change, as proposed by Senator Durbin and Hagel, seems a wise move. To avoid these unacceptable consequences, we have strong indication that global emissions need to be reduced by at least 50% by 2050. To take responsibility for the current situation, developed countries need to reduce their emission by much more than 50%. Only then are developing countries allowed to obtain access to the energy they need. The future can sometimes be portrayed as difficult and grim, but it's also full of promise. I would argue that there is plenty of hope if we only chose to take ambitious action without delay. The frequently cited Stern report has shown that the cost of taking action now is relatively small. I would even go as far as to say that we could make enormous progress even now just by using existing low or no carbon technologies. Properly built houses with double or triple glass windows and good insulation, for example, could constitute a significant part of the solution. This provides a good example of something that can be achieved through existing technologies and that is above all very cost efficient. There is no such thing then as a free lunch, which often comment in US, but a recent study by McKinsey shows that a quarter of possible emission reductions would result from measures such as better building insulation that carry no net life cycle cost. Reducing emissions would actually bring down your energy bill at the same time. And that is exactly what is starting to happen in right now. Countries are reducing their greenhouse gas emissions and becoming much more energy efficient while still maintaining strong economic growth. Some would still insist that substantial emission reductions and phasing out of oil cannot be achieved without threatening economic and social development. I would argue that they are wrong, and this is shown by science and experience. In Sweden, emissions decreased by more than 7% between 1990 and 2005, while our economy grew by 36%. This achievement was made without any quick fixes. It can be attributed to a number of policies and measures. Sweden has a long tradition of an energy policy aimed at reducing emissions. This is done by both through developing and promoting alternative technology, but also, perhaps more important, if you count actually reduced tons of emissions so far, we use market-based instruments such as green certificates and energy and carbon taxes to steer market actors' behavior towards more sustainable patterns. I'm not a fan of taxes, but I'm convinced that they can make an important difference if you want to promote one type of behavior over another. I'm also convinced that we should put a price on emissions. Emissions cost society as a whole. Taxes are one way to make the emitter reconsider his actions. In Sweden, electricity and fuels have been subject to energy taxes for several decades. Sweden was one of the first countries in the world to introduce a carbon tax back in 1991. The tax has had an effect, particularly in heating sector, where the use of fossil fuels has decreased dramatically, mainly due to incineration of biomass and increased efficiency in the use of energy. The power sector is traditionally almost carbon-free. Most of our electricity is produced by hydropower and nuclear energy. Oil is used only for peak load purposes, while an increasing share of the electricity produced by biofuel, combined heat and power, and wind power. In Sweden, the use of oil has decreased by 47% since 1970. Over the same time period, the supply of bioenergy has increased by 60%. As a consequence, Sweden's energy supply mix is now much more differentiated than it was 35 years ago, and our security of supply is much more robust. The transport sector still remains a challenge, but in the past few years, hopeful signs have begun to show even in this sector. Sweden has taken important steps to tackle global warming, but we can do more. But as I said initially, our country can only make a small difference. That's why international action is necessary. In Europe, the recent decisions by the leaders of the European Union member states will be driving developments in this field into the future. In March this year, we clearly linked energy and climate policy through a milestone decision and ambitious targets in both the climate and energy field. The EU objective consists of a 20% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by 2020 compared to 1990 for the period beyond 2012. And it would be increased by to 30% if other developed countries also commit themselves to comparable reductions. By 2020, the EU is to make energy consumption savings of 20% compared to projections and the share of renewable energy in overall EU energy consumption also is to be 20%. At the same time, at least 10% of transport petrol and diesel consumption is to be made up of biofuels. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, it will be difficult to persuade large developing countries to reduce their emissions if we cannot show that it's doable in practice without compromising economic growth. We must show leadership in order to make countries like China and India consider actions of their own. And I say, when I say we, I also mean the US and the European Union. From our experience of a rather successful phase-out of fossil fuels, we conclude that we cannot accomplish this solely by relying on technology push. We need to combine it with a demand pull, which is best achieved through responsible legislation. Setting an appropriate carbon price is essential for the transition to sustainable energy use and is something that is applied both at the EU level through the EU's emission trading scheme and nationally through our own carbon tax. Undoubtedly, the leverage for the climate would be vastly higher if similar cost-efficient schemes would be introduced more widely at the international level. Policies can hardly remain constant when circumstances change drastically. If we are afraid of change and deny the need for it, we might be forced into a new situation under less favorable circumstances. But if we look ahead and decide to act by our own choice, we will find tremendous potential for new activities based on bringing new efficient energy technology and renewable energy to the world market. We highly appreciate the close cooperation we are experiencing in the energy technology field between Sweden and the US, as well between your country and the European Union. But we feel that the time has come to take our international dialogue to the next level. We need not only to work together on the technology of fighting climate change, but also to agree on the overriding goal of reducing greenhouse gas emissions. We should be able to find common ground on how to engage all nations in concerted action to shape a more sustainable future by addressing the global warming issue in a way that is compatible with economic growth. Sweden hopes to contribute to this as we hold the presidency of the European Union in the autumn of 2009, when the post-2012 agreement will hopefully be finalized. We are eager to get results, but we are flexible about how to get them. We know that there is no one-size-fits-all solution here, and we will certainly count on your country to contribute constructively to finding solutions that facilitate international negotiations. The European Union and the US are the key players there. Let's show leadership and let's do it together. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, together we have the power to shape the civilization that we want. As I said in the beginning, the end is not near, but today we have the opportunity to make tomorrow's world a better place. It's in our generation's hand to take these decisions that could change the current trend in climate change. Let's seize the opportunity. What are we waiting for? Thank you very much for your attention.
Mr. Prime Minister, we are all deeply in your debt for a singularly thoughtful and original and penetrating analysis, and with your kind permission, I will borrow your transcript and place it in the Congressional Record tomorrow morning so we can share it not only with all of our colleagues but with the American people at large. Now, the marching orders for the rest of the time will be as follows. We now have 5 votes that members will need to cast. When we return, Chairman Markey will take over the chair and begin the dialogue. In the meantime, my wife will take you up to my office where you will see a tribute to the greatest Swede in Swedish history, Raoul Wallenberg, and we hope we'll be able to give you some good strong coffee to enjoy it with. This briefing is adjourned.
Mr. Chairman, I think there's 10 minutes left to go before the roll call. Is it possible, because I do have to come back, perhaps we could recognize Mr. Blumenauer for his questions, and then with 5 minutes left to go, we could recess.
I'll be delighted to recognize my friend, Ms. Blumenauer.
Thank you, Mr. Prime Minister. I'm curious if you have a sense at this point, you've identified what's happening with the EU and some of the important steps that have come forward. I wonder if you have a sense of ways that we can the United States might be able to partner some of those countries that are outside the Kyoto Protocol, if there are some ways that you think we can sort of bridge the gap, work together, make some progress in ways that embrace some of the principles that you've talked about.
I know that there are a view of Kyoto process of criticism here in the United States and also in other countries who chose not to sign up to it. I think it's very important that to see that that was a process of its time. I think our knowledge is much greater now to the impact of global warming and also our knowledge of the technology, how to use, to decouple economic growth, as I indicated, with carbon emissions. Therefore, I think it's very important to see the political logic when we are now looking ahead, that it might be an international community that gets an international cooperation or solution, or it might be that we will run alongside with different kind of solutions. I think we should be open to that. If it's not possible to find a global answer directly, well, maybe then Europe, as we now have, should go further on, and that we should also see maybe other parts of the world in their way, in their fashion, to take on upon themselves to curb the greenhouse gas emissions. If we then could link them together, I think that's extremely important to do. The emission trading system I referred to in Europe is fairly new. It needs to function much better than it's doing today, and it will do in a few years. I hear that this is also happening on state level in the United States. So let's talk together and see if we can link them into each other. And I'm firmly certain of one thing. There is no country in the world who do not feel from their people that this is a rising concern, that we need to meet this climate change. And that goes for China, that goes for India, that goes for this country, that goes for the European Union. It's very important to remember that. There is coming from beneath a pressure to do something. So I don't think anyone, I know that all of them are not democracies, but even they feel the pressure from people to do something.
I just would conclude, Mr. Chairman, by saying I appreciate the leadership that you are evidencing by your deeds, the same way that in terms of international development, in terms of refugees from Iraq, I deeply, deeply appreciate what your country has done and look forward to partnership in this area and learning from you.
Thank you very much.
Now there are only 5 minutes left to go on the House floor for the first roll call. And so we'll adjourn at this point. When we come back, we'll recognize the senior Republican that is sitting to my left. And we appreciate, Mr. Prime Minister, your indulgence in our ability to actually control our own schedules here on the House floor. So we'll take a brief recess.
Thank you.